bit of professionalism.
Sports coat.
Comes out like he's been drinking out of bath for 10 hours.
All night. What the
fuck? Trying to bake blends there and there and scoops. I'm on the chemical. Trying to bake blends there and there and scoops. Where do you put your gear? Oh, the I've got to get a hit.
What the fuck?
I'm an intelligent man. Irritable, troglodytic, ridiculous, stupid, and unpalatable. Swill. And I'll say it till the cows come home. Thimble, 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 thimble
And good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, to the Gladiators of Sport, show number 17, Mr. Peak, with the great Stephen J. Peak, brought to you by himself. Yellow door, in the cold, the rain, the sleet and the snow today. Ricardo's Tutoria and the almighty Alan Mance Motors.
And not to forget, of course, Green Co Car Park.
And Green Co Car Park.
And JR Training, of course, down in Oakley, our very good friends. JR Training in Oakley.
What about Rainy Rain?
And what about who?
Rain. Rainy.
Rain
Mako.
Mako Mayhem. Rain Mako was bringing in SEN last night and wanted me to speak volumes about our ambulance and our paramedic workers.
Well, fair enough.
A monumental job out there in the community. And let's just pay some homage there because they do a phenomenal job amongst the community, especially late at night, of course, when the city's populated.
Well, could you imagine her giving you mouth-to-mouth resuscitation?
I wouldn't travel in those directions, Philip, because, as you know, young Rain is a former women's junior middleweight boxing champion. And
she'd love to punch the suitcase out of you, wouldn't she? And next to him is the great Troy Zantuck, member of SEN... Good, Bad and the Ugly. And Monday night is...
Team Talk, Phil.
Team Talk, 9 till 10. Don't miss that.
And thank you very much, Phil. I appreciate that introduction. Great to see Peak in Coker.
Next to him is the great Peter Kokotis, soccer extraordinaire, manager, come husband of the year, father of the year.
And a finance broker and expert in the area of finance.
Finance broker.
Which is extremely important. A lot of people out there looking for mortgage... arrangements, financial deals to get their mortgages across the line. Peter Kokotis,
he's the man
of the moment when it comes to organising your finance for your new premises, whether you're building it yourself or getting a builder to build it or whether or not you're buying a ready-made premises. He's the man who can provide the banks, the finance.
Okay.
He's an expert.
So,
and I'm a good listener as well.
Oh, well, it's nice to hear.
Well, you really have to be on this show, Coco. You really have to be. Over to you, Stephen.
Well, there's been some big issues this week, of course. Ladies and gentlemen, you know the format of the show by now. We go through issues for about the first 25 minutes of the show, and from there we go to a new segment that Mr. Troy Zantuck...
So I think that's a lie. I think it's 50 minutes of issues, 3 and 5 minutes of teams, and you trying to sing a song.
Yeah, we will be the song of the week. If I may tell you, was Goodbye Brisbane Lions to the sound of Goodbye Yellow Brick Road.
Well, so, that should be interesting, shouldn't it, Troy? You'd be riveted to the...
Sticking the boots in once again.
Yep.
Mr. Philip Hill, our musical director, of course, and musician, the expert of the 12-string guitar, the impresario of the acoustic 12-string guitar, will be supplying music and vocals with my good self, assisting with vocals at the end of the show.
Assisting... being the optimum point.
It's a can't miss part of this show, ladies and
fabulous
gentlemen.
Fabulous Phil.
Yeah, and he's right here now. And of course, our big supporter, Nancy, who's present. Just on a sad note.
Hi, Nancy.
Yeah, Troy's waving to Nancy. And Nick Bartels has just arrived too. Good to see you, Nick. A massive supporter of the YouTube show.
Hi, Nick.
The Greek Sheik.
Yep, good on you, Nick. And who's here as well, who assists AFL players in this general vicinity with their property matters, assists... well-known celebrities with their property pursuits and does a great job in the neighbourhood and is very well-known there. We're paying homage to a man who died last Saturday night in Sydney Road, Coburg, in an accident, Mr. Dilawar Shah, a very good friend of Nancy's. We pay homage there, unfortunately. A taxi driver passed away in an accident last Saturday night. We do wish all the best to the family and our utmost sympathies there for the family of Dilawar Shah. Thank you. No problems, Philip. Some big issues this week, and I know that people listening to Selection Dissection last night on SEN 1116 when I was on here with Mark Fane and Howard Cotton of AFL Media would have heard us talking about the Rio Olympics, and it continues to get worse. I checked the internet out again today. There's disputes going on between the mayor of Rio with various officials as to how clean the bay is, that they promised the IOC allegedly they'd get it 80% clean. They reckon it's 60% clean, yet the Australian yachtsmen will totally disagree with you and tell you they cannot train properly, the rowers can't train properly. There is dead animals being caught up in yachting apparatus. There's dead dogs floating around in Guanabana Bay in Rio. Dead dogs, there could be the odd dead steer, caught up in the steering of the yachts trying to train. There could be all forms of dead animal life. There's not only that, there's other personal apparatus caught up in that, and I don't want to go into those, where people have thrown plastic appliances into the bay along with sewerage and other filthy matters.
So we got people there already training.
Yes, there's people have been in the Australian team for some length of time. The yachtsmen have been there for some length of time trying to train in Guanabana Bay. And they're having extreme difficulty. They're running into dead animals.
Can you say Guanabana Bay three times quickly?
Guanabana Bay. Guanabana Bay.
Right.
And that they're running into dead animals. They're running into sewerage. They're running into plastic bags. They're running into other forms of personal items that people use in various pursuits that are out there.
Well, we've got 3 weeks to go. They might give a quick whiz round before then and now.
It's a disgrace, Philip. I know you're trying to look for an avenue, an answer to help the good people of Rio, but unfortunately the mayor has failed. The government has failed. Whoever's in charge has failed. Rio should never have been selected for the Olympic Games. It's a disaster already. And we hope that we all get through unscathed. I don't know how they're going to hold the yachting if they don't clean.
Don't fall in.
You wouldn't want. If you fall into that, I'd get a Hercules plane delivered to me by the Prime Minister to take me to an Australian-based hospital. That's what I'd be doing straight away. I wouldn't be mucking around. I'd be getting out of there.
And 10 people have been arrested in Brazil plotting for a terrorist attack at the Olympics.
At the Olympics, yeah, which we found out this morning there's been some terrorist activity, alleged activity.
Oh, you knew that was going to happen, surely.
Well, no, I never assume or presume, but it is a disgraceful situation. The head of security has already said that every Australian athlete will either come across an incident of violence, either be subject to violence, or will see violence take place. They're going to try and have chaperones going out with them when they leave the Olympic Village. If I was an Olympic athlete, I wouldn't leave the village. You know, here you've got a place like Rio where they've got carnival and all that going on. If I was an athlete and I was a swimmer or a runner or whatever I was, trampolinist or an acrobat or whatever.
What would he be doing, Troy, do you think?
None of the above.
None. What is there anything that we could get him to do at the Olympics, do you think? Could he be a buoy in the bay?
We definitely wouldn't have him at the cafeteria, that's for sure. Maybe for the gymnasts, because they've got to stay underweight. So.
What about a wrestler, Coco?
Greco-Roman wrestling? Yes.
Sit on him?
Off the top rope.
There's no ropes in Greco-Roman.
George the Animal Steel.
Hang on a minute. You don't get wrestling entertainment mixed up with Greco-Roman wrestling.
Oh, sorry, mate.
There are no megaphones. There are no managers walking around. It's done on a mat.
But you have been a fan of the great art form of Greco-Roman over the journey, haven't you?
I am a fan of the Greco-Roman pursuit in wrestling because I think you need a lot of skill and dexterity to.
Did you do that at Xavier when you were there?
No, we did not have Greco-Roman. Was one of the few things that we didn't.
It was running around in the fifths in the first day and eight.
No, I was in the fourths in 1972, which was. Let's not worry about what football team I. It's not about what football team I played in or how I went and all the rest of it. You know, we won nearly every game. The years that I was there, we hardly lost a game.
Did you play in a grand final?
Private school were pretty tough in the public-private school system.
Did you play in a grand final?
We didn't have finals. If you finished on top of the ladder, you were deemed premiers. Because what happened with us, Xavier's very big on athletics as well. The athletics start in early September. Right. So there's no finals for our football teams.
So you go straight.
The firsts and the schools there, I think it was whoever finished on top of the premier for the year. We went into spring athletics.
Right.
When Pat Bohesi, the trainer, Robert DiCasella, trained the distance squad, which I was part of, and you had other sprinting.
Did Chris Wardlaw attend to Xavier, Stephen, or Monash?
Chris Wardlaw went to Monash.
Yeah.
Yep, correct.
One of the great distance runners we've produced.
He was one of our great distance runners. Right. The Decostellas, the O'Shaughnessys.
Could I ask the panel, how many gold medals do you think we will win? And how many medals overall do you think we will win in the upcoming Olympics?
I'll tell you what.
The swimmers, they say, are going to be a lot better.
Well, we know that McAvoy's going to be up there because he's broken records and he's made Magnussen look second rate. So McAvoy's there.
Right.
The disappointment again is Magnussen, of course. He's now a bit player, to the whole shebang.
Right. So, Peter, what do you think?
Well, we won't win as many as we won in Sydney, that's for sure.
No, but we didn't do that well in London.
Yeah, no, we'll be lucky to win 5 gold.
5. Troy?
Well, you know what happened there, don't we?
Yeah, I'm a little bit more optimistic.
Shooters are going to go right this year.
Yeah. I think we'll win most of our gold medals in the pool.
The pool, yeah. That's standard.
We've always had strong representation
so
in
a
the
number?
Pool. And it's always very enjoyable to watch. I enjoy it every 4 years watching the greats of the pool do their stuff. So that's the part of the Olympics that I'll be looking forward to.
And how many? So what's your gold tally as a punt? 10?
Maybe 10 to 12.
I was around that, 10 to 12.
No, that's it. People don't understand that we are not in that upper echelon group, and we've got a long way to go. Now, our swimmers have got a lot of pressure on them this Olympics after the massive problems that they brought upon themselves in London. And we know all about that. Most of the male swimmers involved in that are now no longer there. And that's a good thing.
So how many gold do you think?
I believe that the Campbell sisters will be the ones who will star because those girls are red hot at the moment. DeBronte and Kate Campbell, they're red hot. They'll Cornella a few races and they could themselves win golds. They could interchange gold medals, those two.
How many gold? I expect them
to fly. No, but I don't know how many, but I could get a handful for those girls, in gold, silver and bronze.
Right.
We're going to struggle on the athletics track without Sally Pearson there as a flagship. We're in real trouble.
I'm talking about 10 to 12.
Overall,
Stephen. Not just exclusively in the pool.
Yeah, overall. I didn't say you did, Troy. I never said anything about being exclusive. So...
I'd say
6 to 8 gold if we're lucky. We might get to 8, probably more like 6. We'll probably win maybe 8 to 10 silver and a few bronze. But, just because the Russians aren't there, I don't think it's going to be a walk in the park. We're just going to rock it up
the ladder.
But only one country. And hopefully they're in trouble anyway. The athletics take
right
a
so
anyway.
Sorry, I've digressed.
I digressed. Yeah.
Tell me something about football this week.
Yeah. Well, hang on a minute. We haven't finished with the cricket situation yet, have we? The IOC have a big job in front of them right now. They know there's been 312 cases of breaches of the drug rules and regulations. And the wider reports come out. Richard McManus, I think his name is McManus or McLeod, a name like that, has come out and made a report that set out the rampant institutionalised cheating that's been going on there for some length of time. Now, the IOC have to have the guts and they've got to...
Well, they just banned the whole team.
No, they've banned the athletic squad's banned, but they haven't banned the whole country. At this point in time, it's a case of not the whole country gets banned because there's 312 tests carried out. There was a conspiracy in operation where dirty urine was substituted for clean urine after testing.
Peter?
And they believe there are government people involved in that procedure.
It's a hole in the wall, wasn't it?
Yeah, the mousetrap, they called it.
Do you think that we should be banning the whole team?
I think it's a bit harsh.
Yeah, I agree too.
A bit harsh.
The whole country we're talking about, the country. Now, Peter, you've got the floor, Pete.
Yeah, look, I'm not sure. That's a bit harsh to ban the whole country. I think there's a lot of... I'm not of that opinion that you're banning the whole country.
Russia's attitude towards the Olympic Games, which is a pure form of amateur sport, or how it's meant to be, although they now dragged professionals into it 20 years ago, or whatever it was, 15 years ago, and ruined that aspect of it, in my view, with golf and tennis. Russia is in diabolical trouble, and my view is that the IOC will... They've got a serious look at it. They're going to go by that report and stand by it. They've got to ban the country.
Troy, what do you think?
Well, I believe all recidivists should be banned, Phil. Repeat offenders. Yeah.
Don't they get rubbed out for 2 years or 4 years? If you get banned...
Individually, those who have been caught. Yeah, they get their 2-year penalty, their 4-year... It's now 4 years, I think, at the maximum level. If you're a clean athlete in Russia, this is what you've got to do. And I mentioned this last night. You have to, one, leave Russia. Two, you run in the white colours of the IOC at the Olympic Games. The white top, the white trunks, the white socks.
Has that happened before?
You don't have a country. You're not representing a country. Well, this is if they don't do it, this is my suggestion.
Has Peter actually been a country that's running in white?
I'm guessing never.
Peter, have you ever heard of that? I haven't. I didn't even know that you could do that.
Never.
What I'm trying to do is separate the innocent from the guilty. So if you're innocent, you subject yourself to every test. It might be too late now with only 20 days to start.
There'll be no one competing.
No, I'm talking about the Russians.
Peter. I'm saying, if you think only the Russians.
No, hang on.
There'll be no one competing, mate.
Hang on a second.
The whole event's dirty.
These reports were all about Russia. There was whatever tests have taken place, other individual athletes have been rubbed out. The Italian walker, Alex Schwarzer, he's been rubbed out. He's not there. The Italian walker's gone. Jared Talent's now in a position to win a gold cleanly without having to put up with the Russian or the Italian who were causing, have been rubbed out. So, you need to worry about that. Everyone, this is a special report was carried out after Russian athletes themselves reported a doping system 5 or 6 years ago when WADA failed to act 5 or 6 ago, but started 6 or 8 months ago. They got stuck into it and said, we've got to do something. And they finally did something. And now they've got the report. So they can go by that report. If Russia's not happy with that, well, that's tough luck. What's Putin going to do? What's Mr. Putin going to do? Want to go to the World Court? Well, I don't think so. IOC is a private sporting organisation who can ban or not ban anyone they want.
No, that's fine.
So you can run in the all whites of the IOC. Mm. You can distance yourself from your country. You might have to get your family out. You know what I'm talking about here? You might have to get all your family out on a plane or a boat before you compete, if it means that much to you, because who knows what can happen, you know, ramifications.
Righto.
It's sad, isn't it?
Well, it'll be interesting to see how the Olympics go. Everyone said this about Greece, by the way, that it was no good and the joint wasn't ready and all that sort of stuff. Didn't seem to go okay, Peter, didn't it?
Always does.
Yeah, true.
There's always this sort of stuff beforehand, and it's, you know, but it always... They always end up getting a few unfinished roads and concrete and all that, but I don't know, once it started it all seems to come together magically
when the opening ceremony
starts. Unless they have one street that they finish and everything else.
They ran the World Cup there 2 years ago.
Yeah, that's right. So,
it's not like they haven't ran a major event there. It'll get sorted out. Well, you think the Olympic Games isn't going to run?
I think the crime's a concern.
Yeah, it is a major concern. It'll be like a little enclave there.
Question from the audience. A microphone for Mr. Spartels, please. Thank you.
Didn't they in Greece about 4 months before the Olympics started, they said to everyone around the world that they're not going to be able to finish all the stadiums, and they all panicked. And then all the countries came in and gave them a hand, and all the Greeks were giving directions and sat back and while the rest of the countries finished their stadiums.
I can't remember that. Didn't that happen? I remember there was some alarming... alarming reports that the Greeks were behind.
Alarming.
But in the end, it ran like clockwork. You know, so I don't know. They always seem to.
The Greek version of "We are behind with our work," ploy, something that Inspector Clouseau would have been happy with by the sound of it. Now, this idea about they'll get it done in the... You know, I've heard some of the comments made, and this is an observation, gentlemen, not a criticism. They'll get it ready, it'll all happen on the day or whatever. Now, one thing that was truly sitting right here is not interested in is woulda, coulda, shoulda. We're not into woulda, coulda, shoulda.
Well, we go on facts from the past, and you're being Nostradamus and making assumptions for the future. I'm only going on the past, and the past has shown. We've had how many events since 1896? And they've all gone through. So I'm going on past performance. So you keep doing your Nostradamus thing. You are again. So you keep doing that because you're good at it.
And you're good at
hammering others that do it. But so you might have a license. You might have the only license in Melbourne to be the Nostradamus. But let's see.
I said it was an observation, not a criticism.
We'll see. Anyway.
I believe they're in a world of trouble,
but perhaps
they should do what the Greek...
Why are you so...
Get help in from other countries and get it finished.
Why are you so alarmed this time previously...
Because there's violence involved, there's crime involved, and there's appalling, you know, virus-ridden pollution involved. The pollution in that bay is worse than just about anywhere you could ever wish to find. There are chemical pollutants, there is sewage, there are dead animals, And there's also a plastic apparatus used by people in a certain form of personal pursuit, which is out there floating around as well.
And about 2 weeks ago, Peaky, they found a dead body on.
And a dead body on the beach, yes, and a dead human body was found.
Well, it's a third world country.
No excuses.
It's a third world country.
Get help from America and the rest of it.
With a disproportion of wealth. Yeah, right? Yeah. Money's all in, 1% owns or has all the money.
Can't pay their school.
But, teachers. You know, it's well known. It's a country of 150 or 200 million people. Uh-huh. There's a lot of poverty there. But, you know, they do run events. They're a power nation in football, the biggest sport in the world. Yeah. And they're also a power nation in some other sports. I think they're very strong in basketball, aren't they? They've got a lot of sports they're good at. Yeah. Look, in terms of organisation, I can only go on the past, and I think, you know, they ran the World Cup very well. I know Steve's made some valid points. There's obviously some concerns there, but somehow they're going to throw it. There's enough resources. They're not going to allow this to fail. Surely, it'd be the first time in Olympic history.
Well, I can only go by the current status, the facts that are in front of my very eyes as I see what's going on. I cannot and can't look forward to anything that may happen or may not happen.
They said that about weapons of mass destruction, so move on.
Yeah, correct.
The two most compromised Olympics in modern history have been 1980 with Moscow and America boycotting that. Yep. And they paid the compliment back
In 84.
The Russians in 84 in LA. So, yeah, it'll be fascinating to see how many Russian athletes compete at this Olympics.
Yep.
And just on that point, thankfully, 50% or 40% of our athletes in 1980 told Malcolm Fraser where to go and said, no, we're going. We've trained our whole lives for this. Now, if they've gone to attack them, it's got nothing to do with us. We're not politicians. We're not army generals or soldiers. We're athletes. Now, we're going to the Olympic Games.
Oh, it was fair point,
politicians
too, at the time.
Will use the Olympic Games as a political football to suit them at any point in time they want to, because it's the biggest sporting event in the world. Peter might say the World Cup is, whatever. I think still believe the Olympic Games is the biggest.
It's got to be close.
On what KPI
all
is that, Stephen?
Well, most countries, if not all countries, are involved in the Olympic Games.
Well, in terms of viewers, the World Cup is.
Oh, viewers, okay. Yeah, viewers, I'm not...
In terms of people being interested in an actual event and watching it, it's World Cup's number one.
Yeah,
by much, Peter?
By a fair margin?
Oh, I'm not sure, but I know it is.
Well, okay.
See some stats,
I thought it'd be similar to because the Olympics is worldwide as well.
Yeah. Olympics.
No.
The Olympics takes in countries that
losing
don't
follow, its so. Loss. It's lost its.
I'm looking forward to the golf,
appeal.
Troy, aren't you?
Well, lost its
the men's golf at the Olympics.
Well, you don't
I think that'll be just be riveting.
The whole world, mate.
Don't you think, Troy?
Thanks, Phil. I didn't want to talk over anybody.
No, please. That's right.
Parallel conversations.
No, we'll just interrupt.
Golf. I've got to say no, because
the
top golfers won't be there.
Don't tell me.
So, look, I was looking forward to Jason Day. I was looking forward to Rory McIlroy squaring off, but they won't be there. And and we've had this discussion before. Tennis and golf
out
should not be in the Olympics.
No. I might go have a beer.
It is not the pinnacle of their sports.
No,
they're not the Grand Slams of either tennis or golf. To me, they're novelty events.
Yeah, I might go have a beer with Nick Kyrgios because that's the amount of interest a lot of people have.
I think it'd be perfect.
Well, just something, you know.
Just hang on.
When the Olympics is on, most of the time I can't get enough of it, really. The athletics. I'm riveted to the screen. Riveted to the screen when the Olympics is on and the swimming. They're to me just
massive. But you've just hit the nail on the head there, Stephen, haven't you? The athletics and the swimming.
They're the keys to it. And then from there, I divulge into the equestrian events, which I love watching the equestrian, watching the horses do the Fred Astaire with the magnificent foot movement that they get and the rider skills. Also
this is a very good question, Mr. Peake, and to the panel. What is your favourite? We've just said Troy loves the swimming.
Absolutely. Yeah. Right. Number one.
Athletics
Peter,
for me.
Athletics for you. Yep. And Peter, what is your favourite Olympic sport?
Ladies
and gentlemen, I know you can't see this in the camera. I just have to get it out of the light shot. sorry, Peter, what is your favourite?
It was the 100-metre sprint in 1988. And then after that, I just lost interest.
So one in 10
of us. Why? What happened in 1988?
Oh, we're just all, you know, it's all, all the drug cheats.
Is it the Ben Johnson
all the drug
bulging eyeball
found out,
scandal?
Yeah, Carl Lewis in 1984 was on it.
How soft is that?
He was on it in 1984.
So what?
And
what?
Then you find out that all the East Germans in the 70s, they were dying of cancer and brain or cancer tumors, because all those gold medals were all rigged. So then I sort of lost a bit of interest. Now I sort of follow the basketball a few of the hockey, basketball. So I enjoy that. I like watching the Boomers, and I like watching the Hockey Roos.
Cycling's fantastic at the velodrome.
That's massive.
The old Gary Neewon.
The boxing's great. The amateur boxing's good, and also the wrestling. As I said, the Greco-Roman, or Greco-Roman to some people.
To who?
To some people.
No. To who? Greco.
Rory and HG call it Greco wrestling. Greco-Roman. But that's their take on it.
Right.
30 minutes on the Olympic Games.
The equestrian I mentioned. I love the equestrian, I must admit, to see. In fact, a horse I once part-owned, Sugar King, he is, I think, I'm not too sure whether he's in this Olympics. He was in the London Olympics, a horse I previously owned. I didn't mention this to you people. That horse was, he had a throat condition and he couldn't get his wind through the throat when he was racing, and so he got fixed up. Was sold to Jim Carner School and made it to the Olympic Games, and apparently he's worth over $1 million, that horse.
Really?
And we sold him for 1,000, I think, or 500. So just goes to show that how things like that can happen, but can happen.
All right, Olympics, what else we got?
Well, in footy, just to clarify one issue, I mean, Paul Marsh got aggravated during the week because Michael Tellier got stood down by the Sydney Swans over that incident that happened last Saturday. I know that's a lot of people aren't interested in that sort of stuff, but I suggest Paul knows. He knows what's in the player's code of conduct and the standard form player contract. When that sort of thing happens, clubs can stand a player down. They don't need too much reason to stand a player down. If they decide to do it, it's in accordance with that. You've got no argument.
Well, disappointing, but, you know, unfortunately it's a scourge on society, North Melbourne, Peter, do they have to win this week? If they don't win this week, are they G-O-N-E gone?
No, they're already gone.
Already gone.
Yeah.
Really?
Cooked. List gone. Over 30 or whatever. They recruited for today, and today's gone. Pretty much gone.
Troy?
So, they're in trouble.
Yeah, disappointing to see the dramatic slide after being on top after round 12, on top of the ladder.
Well, 7 of the last 8.
Now hanging on to 8th position. I think they'll hang on. But they won't be a factor in the finals, unfortunately, for the North Melbourne supporters. As Coco said, a lot of guys getting on. They've had a bad run with injuries of late. So, yeah, there's the rest of those, the 7 teams, I give them all some chance of winning the flag. It's just it's an extraordinarily even season, Phil.
Still haven't got Hawthorn there at the top?
I've got them by a slender margin. GWS may be the joker in the pack.
Can I ask a question? Is there one team that's less susceptible to one player going down that could just turn their fortunes, you know, south? Is there one team that can handle an injury?
You're talking about players that are virtually a club needs to win a flag. Now, you'd normally say Luke Hodge at Hawthorn, but if Hodge wasn't playing, they can still win a flag if he was injured.
I would say Sam Mitchell, Stephen. If Sam Mitchell went down, a gaping hole in the whole restructuring of the Hawthorn team.
Sam Mitchell?
Yep.
What about Lethal Calder?
St Kilda won't make the final, nothing to worry about, Phil.
The equation is there, we can make it. We're 10-1 to make it. Port Adelaide are 4-1. North Melbourne are $1.13 to keep that spot. Collingwood are 34-1 at 7 wins, 9 losses. They need to have a big finish. But
so do we.
Hear what Troy says about Sam Mitchell. He's a champion. He's a ball winner. And he moves them forward all the time.
Lethal called him a genius week.
Genius. He's a genius because he's got low. He's a short fellow, but he gets not fast, but he gets the ball and he knows where to deliver it.
And he's not a man that gives out accolades very easily. Lethal.
I know. Lee Matthews is an ornament. He's a ornament. Now let me get back to Luke Hodge. Now this is this guy here. In a finals match, Luke Hodge doesn't take prisoners. For two guys who don't take prisoners in finals matches, Lenny Hayes was one and Luke Hodges the other, you get a bloke like that. Blokes like that in finals matches are worth their weight. They're worth 5 players. You know why? Because now they get the ball and deliver the ball or whatever, they're prepared to go into the firing line. They put their body on the line every time and they're happy to cause damage to the opposition, physical damage where they can when they go through. And we've seen that with Hodge and we've seen it with Hayes.
Well, would Buddy be the player at Sydney?
And you've got to have that. If you haven't got a player like that, Buddy would be close to it. I don't think they can. Sydney would not I think, win without him. They could have Tippett in. If they didn't have Franklin, they'd be in real trouble because he is a... He's the guy who is the general on that forward line.
What about
They do go to him sometimes a bit too much. They actually need someone else down there because, you notice last week they dropped the boy they were experimenting with, Ted Richards, who's 32 or something, and they're asking him to play full forward. That's a big ask for guys who played his whole career full back, for crying out loud. They are struggling to find... They need Tippett back in a big hurry. They need both those guys. If they can't get him, they've got to put Sam Reed at full forward. They've got to take pressure off Franklin and allow him to run around creating play at the around the half forward line.
Right.
Yeah, you don't have to be Einstein to see that.
So who do you think, if North Melbourne are gone, Peter, who's going to replace them?
No, I meant they're gone. They're gone for a premiership tilt.
Yes, but if they're gone, they're not going to get it.
Port Power have got the best chance
to
take them on. St Kilda's outside chance because of the average.
Well, realistically Port, because Port are on the same, basically the same percentage as North Melbourne.
Yeah.
Right.
So St Kilda are probably...
Very outside.
Two games and percentage away. So that makes the task nearly insurmountable.
St Kilda will have to, in my view, will have to win the four games against the teams outside the eight, and they'll have to beat one of either the Bulldogs tomorrow night or the Sydney Swans at Etihad. They're going to have to win one of those two.
What about North
have got a shocking draw.
No, St Kilda playing North as well.
St Kilda North, if they beat... Well, St Kilda only went full strength and flying. They beat St Kilda by 7 points. Right now, they're fragile at the moment. They're somewhat fragile.
And Nick Spartel's brought up a great point before. As far as Geelong goes, if Dangerfield, if anything happened to him,
gone.
Curtains for their finals.
And Rory Sloane for Adelaide Crows, would you agree?
He's a bit more replaced because the Crouch brothers. The Crouch brothers, they're getting 30 possessions a week, those boys.
I would say Eddie Betts.
Really? He's good.
He's incredible.
Yep.
He kicks goals. Yep. He tackles. The forward 50 pressure he puts on, it's an intangible. And also his presence. He unnerves the rest of the defenders in the defensive area from the opposition team. He is he's a talisman. He is their good luck charm, Eddie Betts. So if they lose him, I think the Crows, they probably lose two, three goals a game. So Eddie Betts for me.
Righto.
Yeah, Hodge for mine by a country mile because of what I said. He does everything. He does the physical stuff, the quality stuff, the whole box of knots, and he leads them and he tells them where to position themselves.
He's a great leader and he provides structure. But for actual ball getting, Peaky, and the way the ball's delivered, and he's just his generalship around the ground. Sam Mitchell is the compass in the midfield.
He's needed. There's no doubt he's desperately needed. But I suppose where possibly Troy and I differ is that what you need to win grand finals is not always just skill. And that even in the modern era, you've got to have physicality. And that to me is worth its weight in gold. Worth its weight in gold if you can intimidate.
All right. Now,
aside.
Now, why don't we let Troy talk about, because I enjoyed it last week when he spoke about the great Tony Lockett.
Yep.
And this is, now what do we call it again?
Yes. And now, ladies and gentlemen, you want me to introduce it?
Please.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Don't tell
me. It's now time for Troy Zantuck and Yesterday's Heroes.
Oh, yes.
Well, thank you, Peaky. I probably prefer Glory Days, but we'll go with Yesterday's Heroes. Last week we had the great man, Tony Plugger Lockett. Today, another great full forward, one of Hawthorne's absolute superstars, the man they call Hutto. That's right, ladies and gentlemen, Peter Hudson. Starting his football career with New Norfolk, he would kick 378 goals in only 78 games from 1963 to 66. He would attract the attention of every AFL scout, but it would be the Hawks that would secure his signature. Huge fanfare would surround his debut, being round 2, 1967, up against the formidable Wes Lofts of Carlton. He would kick 4 of Hawthorne's 6 goals that day, a sign of things to come. He would win the Hawks' best and fairest in 68 and 70. His goal hauls were quite extraordinary. 1968, 125. 1969, 120. 1970, an incredible 146. And the big daddy-o of them all, equaling Bob Pratt's record, the magical 150 goals in 1971. Incidentally, a Hawthorn premiership year. A severe knee injury in the opening round of 1972 against Melbourne at the age of 26 threatened to end his career after kicking 8 goals in the first half against Melbourne. But Hutto wasn't quite done yet. With a movie star arrival by helicopter to play against the Pies at VFL Park, kicking a lazy 8 goals. In 1975, he would head back to Tasmania and play with Glenorchy, kicking 616 goals, ladies and gentlemen, in only 81 games, finishing his illustrious career in 1981. He would come back to the Hawks in 1977, topping the goal kicking with 110 goals, wearing the famous number one jumper, not the number 26. An interesting story behind that. Rodney Eade was wearing the number 26 Guernsey at the time. Hutto asked for the Guernsey back. Rocket said, "No way, Jose." So Hutto was given number one. His record is absolutely incredible. 129 games for the Hawks, 727 goals. He represented, ironically, Victoria 10 times, Hall of Fame legend, and he won 4 Coleman medals. The average goals in a game, he holds the record. Just over 5.5 goals a game. That's right. Every time Hutto went out there, he kicked 5.5 goals a game. An interesting postscript to this. There were only 4 players to keep him goalless during his career. They include Barry Richardson from Richmond in 1969, Ian Cooper from Collingwood in 1974, Curly Rod Austin in 1977, and the one that I've enjoyed, Bruce Greenhill from Sandy Bay, Tasmania in 1978. Glory days, Troy Zantuck signing off.
Yeah, well done.
Well
Troy.
Done.
Yep, absolute champion Peter Hutson. Also signed a form forward St Kilda, but St Kilda missed out to Hawthorn. Kevin Dennis of Kevin Dennis Motors put $10,000 up to get Peter Hutson to Hawthorn of his own money. Kevin Dennis, a mad Hawthorn supporter.
His name was?
Dennis Gowring. Gowring, I
Dennis
think it was.
Dennis Gowring. Famous restaurateur.
And yep. Art enthusiast also. Had a lot of fine art that he purchased as well. Phenomenal record. Peter Hutson, the best user of hips and body in a one-on-one contest you'd ever see in a full forward.
Yep.
Knew how to manipulate a fullback out of the position, out of the way. Beautiful. It was a mongrel flat punt he used to use, but it always hit the mark.
It was accurate.
Yeah, the whole time. And on top
unlike
of that,
St Kilda,
average of 5 point whatever is the best average for
on
a
the
full
week.
Forward, I think, in the league. I think as far as averages, I think it's better than Lockett's and Dunstall and Coventry. So I think he's got the best overall average.
Did I just not mention that? Or
yeah, you did. You did.
That's all right. No, that's okay. I was also going to mention that he went back to when he went back to Tassie, he could have come back to Hawthorn a lot earlier, but he didn't because he got a massive deal in a hotel financial arrangement in... It might have been Glenorchy, I'm not sure, but he was either...
Well, you said Troy, he kicked what, 800 goals, was it? Or 600 goals?
727.
727, it's a very famous number
how many,
in league history.
How many games?
129.
So, that's amazing.
It's an incredible average.
It is unbelievable.
But he was incredible in his home state too.
Yeah.
Like, to kick 616 goals...
Yeah.
For Glenorchy in 81 games.
Yeah, that's like, yeah.
It's just astonishing.
It is an astonishing record.
And one, as Peaky said, one of the best users of his body ever to play the game. Yes. Would lead many a full forward under the ball, Peaky.
I got him right under there, up there with Lockett as the two best full forwards I've ever seen. Yeah. But he could have come back to Victorian football earlier. He didn't because of the money situation was too
good. Peter, do you think he's better than Lockett? Well, think he was better than...
No, you'd never get that from me.
You asked the wrong man there.
You asked the wrong man there. I mean, the record holder's the record holder. But, I mean, I didn't see him, but I've seen footage and I've seen a lot of... I've read a lot about him. A huge respect for the man. I remember going to St Kilda training once and he was an assistant coach and he was just playing around with the ball and he was kicking it on various different angles and points of the ball and... He was manipulating the ball to go through little goals. It was just amazing. And, one stage, Ken Sheldon, a few of them just stood up and clapped him. He's just a freak. You could just see he was a magical player. And, I love the story in 71, of course, when they played St Kilda and Alan Jeans gets up in front of the team and says, look, we have to allow Hutson, 5 goals today. That's just going to, he's going to kick that. And then Kevin Cowboy Neil at the back said, well, he's got to be standing to kick him. So that was a famous story. And, of course, he got him during the game. He belted him. And I think that would have cost him the record because he was concussed. He would have and he missed a couple from straight out.
Well, famously, he had the chance to kick 151 and Barry Lawrence was on the mark, Stephen, and smothered the ball. Yeah. And Hutto just sunk to his knees upon the ground. Yeah. Hudson, number 26, 150 through the sticks. Just one more goal to beat them all. Come on, Hutto, kick that goal. Yeah.
Cowboy but Neil, he was concussed.
He was concussed. Cowboy Neil did apologise to Peter Hudson when he came to St Kilda as an official.
Who said that, Troy? Who said that, Troy? Thing you just said. About
no, he didn't say.
It was immortalised in a song by Mike Brady.
Oh, right. Thank you.
Yeah, yeah. So
Cowboy Neil did apologise to Peter Hudson for having struck him with a right hand in that game. But people don't realise, and really Cowboy, he cops a fair bit of flack for that, and Hawthorn supporters make a big deal of it. But at the end of the day, Hawthorn, may I say, their brutality at the end of the day was a lot worse than St Kilda's in that match, if you have a look at that game.
Yeah.
So have a look at that. People need to have a look at the whole replay. There are
you still
Hawthorne
got a videotape machine, Peter?
Sorry?
You still got
glasses on.
A VCR machine at home?
I was under the impression, Peter, that we were celebrating Peter Hudson's great career. Yeah. Not just talking about tit for tat.
We've just turned him into a monster.
Who should have knocked out who? Yeah.
For respect for the man, and like John Coleman, didn't have the amount of games to get to, score the amount of goals he would have scored if they got to play the amount of games that the others that kicked over 1,000 did.
Would have been fascinating, Coco, for Hudson to play his whole career in Victoria.
It would have been fascinating.
Well, he would have kicked 1,600 to 1,800 goals.
He would have kicked a lot. I mean, he would have kicked. I mean, it's like we discussed with Lockett. Didn't achieve what he should have because of injury and suspension, and Hudson because of his knee and playing in Tasmania didn't achieve.
Mate.
I think
Dunstall
got completely wring the cloth dry. He got as much out of himself as he could. You just look at Dunstall and say, you know what? He maximised his full potential. Did whatever he achieved. The others like Coleman, 99 games. You know, Hudson, Lockett. You just think, geez. Like it was a little bit more in the tank there, Zanners. You know what I mean?
It's a great point.
Okay, boys, the footy's starting this weekend. We better get on to it then because we've got Phil Hill coming up pretty soon after our selections, tips and our comments about the matches. We've already touched on the final eight and what's going on with that. Collingwood are playing North tonight in a crucial, this is a definite eight-pointer game at the MCG. Collingwood win this. They go 8-9 with a chance, still an outside chance that Oz will drop of making 8th spot. North Melbourne will be 10-7 and starting to look a bit seedy again in that 8th spot. In for the Pies come for Solo, a gold kicker, and can take a good mark for small fellow. And M. Williams in for North Melbourne, the Magic Doors back, and Trent Dumont. Out goes Brent McCaffer and Jared DeGuey. And for the Roos there, Waite's got a hip and Cordy Wagner is out of the side. That's Troy.
Yes, fascinating game with a lot of permutations, Stephen.
Yes.
I think the Pies might cause an upset and North Melbourne continue their slide down the ladder. I think I've been impressed with Collingwood over the last couple of weeks. They really took it up to Adelaide the previous week. So the Magpies by 2-3 goals in an upset, Coco.
Peter.
If you go in recent form, you go for Magpies. I just might go for North. I just might think they've got to turn it around at some stage. Tonight might be the night. They just might do enough to get it over the line.
Well, to turn it around, Petrie's going to have to increase his output by about 80%. We know that Brown's doing all he can, but you need more than one forward up there. Some of the other players like Zeeble and Cunningham and these fellows, Gibson, have gone missing. We know they're getting a bit older, but they're also out of form. I think they lost a bit of confidence. I'm not too sure what it is, but they were flying earlier on in the piece, and now they seem to have all sorts of issues. So to me, Collingwood, they flogged GWS on their home soil 2 weeks ago, and they lost last week. Having to go to Adelaide, was it? I think they went to Adelaide.
Yes, they did.
In 6 or 7 days, they've had to go interstate twice. You know, last week I forgive them for that. I just cancel that as a no-run run, so to speak, as I say in racing. And say that Collingwood will beat North tonight by 5 goals. I believe they'll continue on with their form, and Buckley's put the pressure on big time. Sydney playing Carlton, 5 goals for me, Collingwood, tonight, and Pete's gone for North and Troy for Collingwood there as well. Into Sydney there, v Carlton there. That's happening at the SCG there. $1.04 Sydney, Carlton $11 as you'd expect. In Cunningham, Xavier Richards, Foot and Kearney. And out goes his brother, Ted Richards, Xavier's brother. It's not a full forward, we know that. Wearing a helmet these days too. McVeigh's got a groin and Zach Jones with an ankle. The new boy is Jordan Foot from the Swans Academy. Another Academy player coming through that Eddie McGuire's always whinging about. In comes Casbolt and Bokehurst for Carlton. Out goes Lamb and Jacks, Troy.
Another Academy player, Stephen. That's Isaac Heaney and Callum Mills. Not, they go okay. So if Foot's half as good as those two, wow, watch out. Sydney, home. Carlton, very, very close. They got very close last week after a disappointing start, a very disappointing first half by the Blues. But they got within 7 points of West Coast at the final siren. Mm. So Sydney, after being in an absolute thriller against the Hawks, I'm looking for them to hit back and win by 6 to 8 goals. Coco.
Sydney will be too strong for Carlton. But I think Carlton supporters will be very enthused by their comeback last week. Lot to look forward to next year, especially if they can get it forward. Next year, they're obviously going to be in the hunt for one. But Sydney, yeah, they've got a lot to play for, and you'd like to think 6 goals at least. Yeah.
Look, when you see a team like Carlton that did have a lapse after picking up a bit of form and they're a young side, but to do what they did last week on the MCG against West Coast, I mean, that was a mighty effort. I didn't expect to see that. Well, I think that they're getting a second wind.
It says more about West Coast, doesn't it?
Well, it probably does. But the West Coast, as we know, they do struggle to win on the away game situation, and they're flat track bullies at home. We know that, and I must admit that I've gone right off them. I believe West Coast, they've got a sour look about them. But Carlton, I think they're going to push Sydney right out. I don't think it'll be anything less than 1 to 2 goals. Sydney, I go Sydney only because it's up there, and they will be hurting from last week. They've lost a couple of tight games, but Carlton, to me, with their young kids coming through, they'll do the best they can and put up a show. I don't think they'll get flogged. Gold Coast lead from Mandel in an interesting test for both sides there. In Rosa, Scowen to Field. Out goes Hallahan and Hall. The new boy is Scowen Field. He's from Peel Thunder at the Gold Coast. In for Fremantle, Zach Clark, Eddie Langdon, that's Tommy's brother, and Shane Yaron gets his go. Pavlich is being rested, as you'd expect, and not having to fly to the Gold Coast, having to sit in business class or normal class and get your knees and hamstrings tightened up. Ballantyne with a facial fracture, copped a whopper last week, and Barlow with a shoulder. So they've lost a couple of decent players from Mantle. Troy.
Yeah, look, I'm only just based on where the game's being played, got the Gold Coast. And it should... Fremantle have actually... They've showed quite a bit in the last couple of weeks, but... just because they're playing on the Gold Coast, I think it'll be a tight game, Peaky. Coco, probably 1 to 2 goals. I'll just get over the line.
Yeah,
now, Peter, what do you think?
I'll flip the coin on that one. Don't rate either team. This year, they've been very disappointing for their fans. I think Gold Coast obviously had injuries and Frio.
Well, they're talking about Gold Coast being in the finals next year.
They'll get a lot of players back, and Frio will too. So I'm sure they're going to be different sides next year.
I hope Gold Coast win.
Yeah, look, I'd go for the home side.
If anything, just to stick it up the white wiggle, Peter.
Yeah, that's right. I'm not confident, though. Not confident. The white wiggle, yes, anything to stick it up him. But but Gold Coast, I'm not confident, though.
Well, the white wiggle.
Well, that's interesting, isn't it? Wow. Well, Gold Coast... What they've got to be careful here, Fremantle, is they've got to watch May for the Gold Coast, because he's capable of taking someone out. As we've seen, he's brutal, this boy. And if you get in his road, he's like a semi-trailer without brakes.
He's caused Jake Stringer to miss this week for the Bulldogs.
Well, he has.
Done us a favour.
Very heavy.
And he's put St Kilda in a position where that's going to help us out big time. So Lynch can kick goals down the other end, and Peter Wright, of course, the one they've got. But I believe that Dawson can handle... one of those, and Collins. I believe that it's Fremantle at the moment. Two boys who are in red hot form, good form, are Dawson and Collins down the back line. They've been resolute in the last 5 or 6 weeks, and I believe they can handle those two forward guys. If they can win those two positions, Freo win the game. That's what it comes down to here. And Lachie Neal's going to get a lot of the ball in the middle. There's no Gary Ablett. O'Meara. There's a lot of their blokes missing.
Prestia's
out.
But you bring up Lachie Neal, Stephen, and he has had an absolutely outstanding year. I love watching him play. When I watch Fremantle play, he's a pleasure to watch.
He's a pleasure.
He's hard at it and gets plenty of it.
No, you're spot on there, Troy. And we know that Dawson can play a tough go at fullback. He likes to come in hard with the fist up, the knee up, and everything's up.
They're actually talking about players that actually touch the ball. So,
Righto, next game.
The job of a defender, in my view, is still to stop his opponent from kicking goals or to have an effect on the game. Now, I saw Tom Hawkins last week have no effect for Geelong in their win over Fremantle because Dawson was, in my opinion, Lockie Neal was their best player, Dawson was their second best player. In my view, Sam Collins their third. West Coast v Melbourne. In comes McKenzie, Giles, Duggan and Nelson for West Coast. Out goes Brown, Schofield, Saw, McGinnity and Hutchings are out. And for Melbourne, of course, big changes there. In comes Big Dawes again coming in for another go. The boy studies law in his spare time there. Sam Frost is in. Neil Bullen and Stretch. Out goes Scribes, Kennedy, Vandenberg with the hip and White, Troy.
West Coast by plenty. At home. They'll
faith in Melbourne, have you?
Well, they were very disappointing, I've got to say, after a six-goal first quarter against St Kilda last week and were pretty much taken to the cleaners for the rest of the game. Outplayed by St Kilda in the last three quarters. And West Coast, gee whiz, their form was absolutely, was terrible. Let's be honest, against Carlton. Back on the expanses of Subiaco, they'll be looking for some percentage and I think Melbourne may provide that.
Yes, Peter?
Oh, yeah. I concur with Troy on all those points. West Coast, easily.
You've got one team who's a bully at home and basically is insipid away from home, another team that's insipid at Etihad and insipid away. So what we've got is one team that's more insipid.
It just sounds like they're insipid.
They are insipid. Peter? Sorry, Phil.
John, thanks, Harry.
Peter for a minute.
Sorry, Wiggle.
Sorry, Phil.
Sorry, Peter.
For mine, West Coast, only because of the home ground.
Sorry, mate. Have you met Phil Mance?
Sorry, Philip. And that, I have.
That's Peter to your far left.
Nearly called him another name then, too.
No, I'm Jake.
Jake. But that's not a good name to have, as we know. West Coast for mine, possibly by nothing more than two goals. What we're going to see is just an appalling game of football.
All right.
The Western Bulldogs are playing St Kilda at Etihad tomorrow night at 7:25 p.m. In as Liberatore, out goes Jake Stringer with a shoulder that was called, as we heard, courtesy of Stephen May.
This could be the game of the round.
It will be. In comes Savage and out goes Minchington. And in fact, Peter Kikunas will tell you I tipped that last week, what would be taking place this week, and I've been proved correct. Troy.
Yes, you've been proved correct. Wow.
So who's going to win?
Western Bulldogs by 3 to 4 goals. St Kilda, I've got to say, a tremendous performance last week. It should be a cracking game.
Only after a slow start, though, Troy.
Yeah, but
Phil,
to St Kilda's credit, they come home with a wet sail.
They did.
So their confidence is up. The Bulldogs did what they had to do against Gold Coast. Stringer out, not good, but I think they've got enough firepower to cover that.
I think Liberatore is back in, though, isn't he?
Tom Liberatore is back, and what a great inclusion he is.
Peter?
Well, we know what you're going to say.
Well, the experts keep backing against us. They don't rate us.
Correct.
And that's great because we just keep doing what we're doing. And we should have won by 70 points last week if it wasn't.
We couldn't kick straight.
Yeah, 20. I mean, we absolutely destroyed them.
Yep,
they weren't in the game. And they're well touted as having this exciting young list, and they've been talked up. And we gave them a real touch up. So I'm very buoyed by the fact that Stringer's out, and I'm hoping Boyd. Well, you know, if they're expecting Boyd to kick a whole lot of goals, then. Well, that's great because I think we're in for a real, real good chance tomorrow night. I'm going to go with my heart, and I think I'll say we're going to get it over the line, St Kilda.
Right, next.
Yeah, well, look, Boyd is back, and he does have ability, this kid. I mean, he will be very good for them, but he's just coming back now. Redpath is a little bit hot and cold for them. So if their two keys don't have much impact on the game, I don't know where. I know that the Bulldogs will get goals from their smaller players, and they have got a lot of run through the middle of the game. But St Kilda play a fast-moving, very fast-moving game through the corridor, which is Alan Richardson has told them to take risks, and they do that. They did it against Melbourne. That's why Melbourne, apart from the goal-kicking, got back in the game a couple of times. They got the ball back there at the back end, and St Kilda were found you know, with men up the ground, etc., and they've got a couple of easy goals. But, you know, what I've had a belly full of is people saying how good Melbourne are and how great they're going to be and all the rest of it. And St Kilda have flogged them twice. I know what Eddie had. Flogged them twice this year because scribes, once they make their mind up, they just refuse. They stay araldited with their opinion and don't look at the facts. The facts and substance of what's taking place. That's what makes me agitated about them, but they're entitled to their own opinion. Good luck to them. St Kilda, still a little bit short in defence because, of course, we know why. But the team is on the up and on a roll. To me, St Kilda will win this game because they'll be tacking the ball ruthlessly and they're going in super hard. If Armitage gets back to his early season form, he will barrel some of these young Bulldogs players and just barrel through. St Kilda by a couple of goals. Now, Geelong Adelaide, we'll be quick here. We've got a bit of time. Geelong, you'll tell us, Philip, if we're running out of time. Geelong, in okay. Martin Muse. Out goes Henderson and Kincatcher with a concussion, as we saw last week, and Murdoch. In comes Brown and Laird, out for Mackay and Seedsman for Adelaide Troy.
Yeah, one of the games of the round, no doubt about it, Peaky. Geelong at home. Not great last week against the Dockers. Looking for Adelaide to knock them over. Adelaide in superb form. 3-4 goals.
Peter?
Yeah, I've lost my confidence in Geelong. I backed them a couple of weeks ago at home. They let me down, so I'm going to go for Adelaide. I think they're third best team going around at the
clean
moment.
Sweep. Geelong by probably Adelaide for anywhere from 8-10 goals. Henderson out's a big loss. He's been in good form, actually. And now you see Bartell's slayed up. They've got players slayed up all over the place. And they're mutton dressed as lamb. Geelong has finally caught up with them. They should have stayed on the rebuild with the kids. They went down the token recyclable track. Good recyclables, as I keep saying. There's a difference. But that's affecting them to a certain degree. And perhaps they should have stuck to what they were doing and gone the full way. Adelaide for mine by a big margin. They're on the way to top of the ladder too. They'll win the minor premiership, Adelaide. They'll finish with 19 or 18 wins. They're Essendon v Brisbane Lions there. That's just my opinion. I'm not being Nostradamus. Essendon v Brisbane Lions there. Wouldn't want anyone to get me wrong. In comes Cooney, Polkinghorne, Michael, Francis. Out goes Gwilt with a knee. That's the extended bench in Brisbane there. It doesn't really matter, does it? But in comes Merritt, Walker, Dawson and Smith. Out goes McStay with a leg. And the new man is Archie Smith from Mount Gravatt or Gravatt.
Yeah, we're short on time, Stephen. So I'm going for the Bombers in a close game.
By
2-3 goals.
Yeah. Peter?
I'd love to see Lions come up because I'd like to see Essendon win a wooden spoon, but I think Essendon will win, unfortunately.
Essendon by 10 goals to 12 goals. Hawthorn v Richmond there. In comes Langford. 10-12 goals Essendon. Dan Hurd to kick 6. In comes Hawthorn. In comes Langford. Brian Heatherly. New boy, Kurt Heatherly there from Sandringham Dragons. It's a breeding ground for a lot of top players. Milestone is Mitchell. We mentioned him before. Troy did 300 games. In comes Lambert, Conker, Drummond and Lennon for Richmond. And I'll be quick here. Hawthorn by 10 goals. Troy?
Yeah, Hawthorn by 6 goals.
Pete?
Hawthorn by 8 goals. I go in the middle.
Yep, that's okay. Richmond to me are cooked, finished and done and dusted for the year. And they have a good look at themselves. Port Adelaide, the GWS there. Port Adelaide, cracker Ebert to Butcher and Pollock. Out goes Addiction there with an ankle. Big loss. Impey, Eve Milestone, gun 50 guns, Grave 150 games. In for the GWS, Wilson, Stewart, Barrett. Barrett, that is Kennedy. Out goes Steele with a hand, Troy.
The Smoky for the Premiership, GWS by 6-8 goals.
All right.
Peter? I agree with Troy. GWS will win this.
Yeah, can't see Port Adelaide winning this. GWS just get home, but Port Adelaide are very flaky. But GWS by 1-2 goals. And right now we're going to our music segment of the day here at Yellow Door, this great eatery here in South Melbourne.
Have you two blokes got up and walked away?
Right here, if I just, Phil starts the music there, Yellow Door, with a locals company relax, the coziest cafe in Albert Park, with the fireplace inside, all weather heated courtyard.
What sort of statement's that?
The kids and you dogs are always welcome. With winter well and truly here, nothing better than the New Mex eggs or the legendary YD big breakfast for lunch. The Palmer is a local favourite. Or try the new
What's going on? Where have you gone? What's happened?
I'll leave it to the professionals, Phil. Daily.
But hang on, that's why we should be there. Because he's not.
Bread or white versus $22. Open 7 days for breakfast, brunch and lunch with free Wi-Fi and great kids menu. Yellow Door where the locals come to relax. And now it's Phil Hill with Goodbye Brisbane Lions to the tune of Yellow Brick Road.
And the White Wiggle.
Warming up.
Now, thank you to Stephen J. Peake, the great Phil Hill.
You're gonna stand down.
Oh, God.
When are you going to land? You should have stayed on the farm. Have listened to the Matthews man. You know the Brisbane Lions aren't forever. They didn't resign you up with you. You're not a present for the Lions to open. Your boys are too young to be playing the blues. Goodbye, Yellow Brick Road, where the Lions of society howl. Let Leprechaun stay in the penthouse. He's going back to his plough. Back to the howling old Lions woods. Hunting the Queensland toad. When he finally decides his future lies beyond the yellow brick road. Yellow brick road. What do you think Cliff will do then? I'll bet they'll shoot down his plane. Take Brisbane a couple of vodkas and tonics to get on his feet again. Maybe they'll get a replacement. There's people like Herdy around. Coaches who ain't got a penny. Waiting for a chance on the ground.
Oh dear.
Yellow Brick Road, Lions of Society howl. Leprechaun stay in the penthouse. He's going back to the plough. Back to the holy old Lions of the woods, hunting the Queensland toad. When he finally decides to utilize beyond the yellow brick road.
Oh dear.